Let's try that one more time. Happy New Year. Great to be with you. We're excited that you're here with us today. If you're a guest with us, welcome. We hope that you've already been made to feel welcome. We'll have an opportunity here in just a couple of moments to stand and to greet each other as we do each and every Sunday morning. If you're checking us out online at fbcmorganfield.org, we also extend a warm welcome to you all. Very warm, as I understand it's maybe close to 40 degrees later today. But thank you for being here and braving the elements and the cold temperatures to be here as we worship the Lord together. It's always a special time. Especially today, we have a baptism here later in the service. Emily Davis will be baptized. Brother Bill's back in the baptistry, and we'll be sharing alongside that here just a little bit later in the service. Lots of other things in the life of the church. We've started off Wednesday night for the first Wednesday of the new year this past week. But if you weren't able to make it, we'd love to see you this week. All the regular schedule resumed last week. So we, weather permitting, Lord willing, we're here on Wednesday nights and look forward to a wonderful semester together. I know our kids are excited about what they're going to be presenting and working toward. And so many things, and Brother Bill could say the same thing about youth ministries and all those kind of things as well. So excited about that. Take advantage of that. We'd love to see you on Wednesday nights as we fuel up for the semester. If you are a guest with us, there's a card on the end of each pew we'd ask you to fill out, and that'll be your gift to us today. That's all we need from you is just some information that we'd love to get. And again, thank you for being our guest. You're part of our family today, and we're excited to have you here. I will direct you to the SID that the ushers have given you as you come in to have a few announcements. There are other announcements in the newsletter on the website, on Pastor Tim's Tim's Thoughts. Lots of different ways to communicate information, but the SID is also another great way. So hopefully you got one as you came in. If not, as we stand and greet one another, I'd invite you to find one. And let's do that right now. Just take a moment, greet some folks around you, and we'll continue on in worship. Join me as we go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for your blessings. Thank you for bringing us here to worship you. Thank you for each one who can, within the sound of my voice, whether it be here in person or joining us online, wherever they may be, help us to feel and experience your presence in a great and mighty way today as we celebrate you. And thank you for all that you've done and continue to do in our lives. Thank you, Lord, for the power of canceled sin that comes from knowing you and trusting in you. Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, thank you that you have the power to overcome whatever the world brings our way, and we just give you praise for that. Help us, Lord, today to trust in you and to receive truth. I pray for Pastor Tim as he leads us. Thank you for Emily and her baptism today, and for Brother Bill, and just each and every expression of praise and worship that we offer you. May it be pleasing to you.
Thrown in the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless. believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light, forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe
Bible up here, sitting on the floor, so we better move that so it doesn't get wet. I noticed one thing about our Bible. The edges are all curled up. That tells me it's used. And I'm so pleased with that. Emily Davis has been a part of our youth family for a number of years, and I've watched her grow in her spiritual life. I would rather listen to her than many other people teach, because when she teaches, she uses examples from the scripture, how it's already applied to her life. And so I know that when she teaches, she's teaching reality of who she is with Jesus. And so I'm so proud of who she is, and more excited about who she's going to become as God continues this journey. And so today we get the privilege of sharing this moment of her journey with Jesus together. And Emily, based on that, what is your profession today?
Jesus Christ is my Lord.
Okay, and upon that profession, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Join me in prayer. Jesus, there was a day when you did this. And I can't help wonder, every time that someone is baptized in your name, it takes you back there yourself, and you remember how it pleased your Father. And these moments please you. And so what we pray is your church, that you'll be with Emily in her journey, and that we'll walk with her as long as we can. And we'll pray for her when she's no longer here, but doing the journey on her life. We know you'll be with her, Jesus. We thank you for the way you work in people's lives. Holy Spirit, we thank you for your work. God, we thank you for sending your Son. In whose name we pray. Amen.
Jesus, come now, fountain, every place to my heart to see thine grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing. to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Your grace covers us all. So thankful for that, Father, this morning. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, that came to cover our sins with his blood. Father, bless this offering this morning for your honor and your glory. We give it all to you in your name. Amen.
When all you see is here and now, when everything is crumbling, falling to the ground, this is just a moment, this is not forever. I know it seems impossible when all your hope is gone, but God is,
greater than the pain, isn't he? Whatever you've gone through, or whatever you will go through this year, just remember that God is able to take care of your pain, and he's able to walk with you through it. You know, for some strange reason, God doesn't always take our pain away, does he? But he's with us in the middle of the pain. For the next couple of months, I thought we would start 2018 answering some basic life questions. We're going to wonder together. Questions like the existence of God. Is God real? Why do bad things happen to good people? I'm going to talk about that next Sunday. Will God answer my prayers? And What about God's will? That's just kind of the top of the surface that we're going to talk about this month. This morning I want to talk about a question that many people ask. I wonder, is God real? And maybe you've defined God as real as a Christian and you've been coming to this church for eons of years, or you just got started and Emily just got her baptism and her profession of faith, and which is awesome, and she's beginning her journey, but she's a strong Christian. But I'm telling you, there are people in our culture who are asking that question. Around the water cooler at work, or around the classroom, or around maybe it's a teacher's break room, or wherever you're at in life, people are asking these kinds of questions. And even so, the Barna Research Group conducted a poll to get some answers about faith. And they asked a cross-section of American adults this question. If you could ask God any question about your life, what is the single most important question you would want to ask him? And the magazine USA Today conducted a similar poll by asking readers, if you could get in contact with God directly and get an immediate reply, what would you ask? Not surprisingly, the results of the polls returned very similar results. Many of the questions had to do with suffering. You know, why does God allow suffering in life? Purpose, what is my purpose in life? Life after death, where do we go when we end? The end of the world and God's will. I believe it is safe assumption that many people ask the same kinds of questions, even those in the church and in our culture. You know, a lot of people feel ashamed for having doubts and questions about faith in God. They fear that they're going to be accused of not trusting God enough or being spiritually mature enough. Often there are people of faith who are eager to criticize others who dare to question God. How could you dare question God? I think it's unfortunate because there is more faith in doubt than most people realize. In fact, if you open the pages of Scripture and throughout the Bible, you're going to find many of them, including biblical writers themselves, who went through intense periods of doubting and questioning God. Many, many people, Jonah, Jeremiah, we could go through probably all the prophets. At one time or another, they all wondered, what am I doing? Where am I going? God, are you up there? Do you see me? Even Job, who stayed faithful to God, but you know he had to have some doubts in his mind when he lost everything. But all of these folks came out of the other side of their experience stronger in their faith. So honest doubts and questions about faith are not only about finding answers, but it's also about discovering the truth. And that's kind of where we are this morning. I have a guy that I talk to pretty regularly, a friend of mine. He is witty. He's very intelligent. He's able to speak on a lot of subjects. He's got a lot of thoughts about politics. He's able to speak on a lot of topics with a very keen intellect. But about spiritual issues, when the subject comes up, he tells me, Tim, I just can't believe in God. And I said, do you mean you can't find yourself choosing to accept God? He said, no, I really mean that I don't believe that God exists. How can anyone believe in God when the world is as a mess as it is? He said, I could do a better job running the universe. And as a pastor over these nearly 30 years, I've had similar conversations with people about God like the one I had with my friend. And I think it's interesting that the conversation changes a lot of times when people find out I'm a pastor. I mean, I'll begin a conversation with someone and their language is kind of worldly and they're kind of who they are. And then they say, well, what do you do? I say, well, I'm the pastor at First Baptist Morganfield. Oh, pastor, I'm sorry about my language. I'm sorry, you know, I'm sitting here drinking his beer and we're having this conversation. Look, dude, just be who you are. Their change is incredible, but I run into many people that express an inability to wrap their minds around the existence of God. For so many people, they can't believe in something they cannot see, they cannot touch. Some people just aren't really sure what they believe. Some waver back and forth about whether or not God exists. Others believe in God, but they're not sure about the nature of God. Is God loving? Is God hateful? Does God care about the world, or has God completely abandoned us? And so they study world religions, and it just confuses them even more. In addition, many of them look to the behavior of those who claim to believe in God and are not impressed with what they find. And I think it's a sobering indictment on the church as a whole. Not just this church, but in church in general, especially in America. I suppose the number one thing that people say to me about church is this: I love Jesus, but I want nothing to do with the church. And we're seeing these statistics decrease in church attendance through the Southern Baptist Convention nationwide. And not just our convention, but many other denominations. Whether we want to believe it or not, this is the mainstream cultural response to spiritual issues. And we're seeing massive declines in the church. I don't know why. Except I think people are tired. All of us at one time or another have wondered about the existence of God. I think it's good for us to be transparent. I think it's good for us to be honest and look for good answers. I think it's important that we understand this point. Rarely are you going to convince someone that God is real. At some point, each of us has to make a personal choice to accept God or not. You see, Christianity is about faith. If it's nothing else, it's about our faith. The Bible teaches us truth, but we have to have faith in what it says is real. And so the first thing we need to understand is this. Everything originates with God. If you have sermon notes, you want to follow along. This is our first blank. Everything originates with God. People have been wondering about God's existence since there has been human beings on the earth who could reflect on the meaning of life. The question of reality of God goes to the core of human existence. For most people, what they believe about God determines about what they believe about their lives and how they should live. In other words, their belief in God or not in God determines their life, their purpose. And of course, there will always be people who I call practical atheists. These are people who look the part, act the part, go to church, even give some of the offering, do lots of churchy things, but they do not have a personal relationship with God. They believe in God, but they act as if there is no God. By what they say, by what they email, by what they send, by how they live their life, their attitudes reflects a non-godly life. If God exists, life matters. So many people, if God does not exist, then we're left to our own plans and our own truth being a relative idea depending on the impulse of the culture. And that's what we see today. More and more, you hear the terms, well, it's just relative. It depends on where I'm at. I've even heard Christians say that. That they don't believe in an absolute moral code. That the Bible is ambiguous at best. Those who believe in God feel that without God there is no morality, no goodness, and no absolute truth. Because God is the source of all these things. And we wonder why our world is a mess and it's filled with sin. Another thing we need to learn today is that the Bible does not prove the existence of God. Now stay with me because some of you are probably going to go, huh? The Bible does not set out to prove the existence of God, and I'll teach you that. But I think we need to turn to God's Word and let God speak to us about this. Let's turn to Genesis chapter 1, and would you stand with me in the honor of reading His Holy Word? Catch this first four words. In the beginning, what? Let's do it again. In the beginning, God. God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. Then God said, let there be light. And there was light, and God saw that the light was good. And then He separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day and the darkness night. And evening passed and morning came, marking that first day. Pray with me. In the beginning, God. I guess, Father, first, and I guess as humanity, we should say that we're sorry when we've existed, we've not looked at or not stood on the promises of Your Word. When we've questioned Your existence. When we've wondered if You're there. Give us faith. Give us stronger faith. Give us the ability to find faith. And help us to be able to communicate that to others. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. attempt to convince us that God exists. The Bible clearly assumes that there is a God. God simply is. Psalm 14:1 says, "Fools say in their hearts, there is no God." So from a biblical perspective, what is obvious and evident does not need to be proven. There are many compelling and convincing arguments for the existence of God. Scholars, philosophers, and theologians have used them for many, many years. A lot of these arguments are known within Christian theology, the study of Christianity, as general revelation, which means that they're based on what is generally known and observable. Some church leaders don't like talking about the evidence of God's existence and fear that it will cause more fear than it will help. But I disagree. I always believe the best way to know anything is more study, more research, more time with God, more time with God's word. And there are some logical arguments to explain if God is real, and we're going to go through those today pretty quickly. The first one is the design argument. The design argument. Many people have reasoned out this argument on their own without realizing that it has a name or an official destination or distinction. It's set out by philosopher William Paley. This simple argument is also known as Paley's watch. Basically, the argument goes that if you happened upon a watch, never having seen a watch or heard of one, and you broke it open to look at its intricate parts, now not these new digital deals, but the old time with the hands and the times and all the works, you would conclude that this watch had to be made by a watchmaker. In the same way, the world we observe is way too complex and too beautiful to have happened just by mere chance. There is no way that you and I came out of some slime algae somewhere eons ago and developed to who we are today. The world must have been created by a design of an extreme divine intelligence. Many of us had the experience that Paley reasoned out. We observe a beautiful tree, a flower, maybe a beach, and say, you know, only God could have created that. There's just no way. The psalmist was expressing the design argument when he said in Psalm 139, 14, "I praise you, God, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well." Just a glance at beauty and the wonder of our bodies and the intricacies, and we are compelled to conclude that there is a God who is behind everything. That's the design argument. The second one is the first cause argument. It's sometimes referred to as a cosmological argument. Most people believe this argument began with St. Thomas Aquinas, who sought to discover the cause of the origin of our world. And the first part of this argument states that every event has a cause. Nothing comes from nothing. There had to be a start. Even the Big Bang had to be a start, a connection. This pulpit that I'm looking at, that I'm behind, did not just appear out of thin air. It was created and fabricated in a shop. It was designed and created by someone. Aquinas believed that if we go back far enough, we can find the first event, which is the first cause for all the subsequent events. The second part of his argument is that things move because they are moved by someone else. Nothing gets moved by itself. Like balls on a pool table, they move because they're struck by other balls. Aquinas argued that the ultimate cause of all the events and movements is God. He's the one who started moving things into order. He began to create. The third one is the moral argument. And this argument states simply that our sense of right and wrong comes from God. For example, we know that trying to save a person from drowning is right, and throwing someone incapable of swimming into a lake is wrong. I was one of my VBS, when I was like in youth and children's ministry way back in the day, well, we're talking like more than 25 years ago, And I did one of those crazy, silly things that I said, if we get so many amount of kids, I'll let them throw me into the pool. And what I didn't know was the pool was over 6 feet tall and beyond. And there was a shallow part, but I didn't let them throw me in that part. I decided to let them throw me in the deep part. And I thought it'd be just one kid or two or three, and it would push me in. That'd be the end of it. No, they pushed me in, and then right when I get ready to surface, another one jumped on me, and 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 I almost drowned because I couldn't get to the bases. I couldn't get I couldn't even catch my breath. I couldn't catch my air. It's interesting that the difference between right and wrong, you know, they did not know that I was almost drowning, but I bet you the next time I do that, I will be sitting in the shallow side, okay, because I think I can handle little kids that way. They say that, you know, a lot of people have based their feelings on God on emotion. If it feels good, then we believe it. But the world is chaotic at best. And there is a God because God is the only logical source of what is right and wrong. That's the moral argument. The existence of religion is another argument. It's less known, but it is still a less important argument for God's existence is the reality of religion in the world. A study of history will show that religion has played a vital role in every human culture. Even individuals who live in the furthest remote places of the world have some sort of religion. They believe in something. There seems to be an innate desire in human beings to worship something bigger than themselves. The question is, who am I, and is there anything more? This desire could only come from God. We are designed to be connected to our Creator so that we will naturally express what we're designed by God to do. There truly is a God-shaped void in all of us that only God can fill. I'm telling you, there are people in the world who just came out of Christmas experience or whatever, and so January tends to be a little flat. You know, we kind of crescendo into Christmas, and then we get into the new year, and you can look around and know that, because at Christmas we were packed out in the first Sunday of January. It's not so much. The world becomes a little flatter. But eventually they're going to ask the question, what's left? What's next? Who am I? Where am I going? And does this all really matter? Only God can fill that void. The significance of Jesus Christ argument. How are we to know what a higher power is like? Well, we just came through Christmas. God, Emmanuel, God with us, enter Jesus Christ. Because we are limited and finite human beings who will never fully understand and know God on our own need, we need God to come down to our level, to be one of us, to show us his nature. And he did that through Christ. In Christ, God demonstrates for us what it is like and proves his love towards us by ultimately dying on the cross for our sins. The gospel of Jesus, the birth, the ministry, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ make God's nature and power real for us in a way that you and I can understand. More importantly, through Jesus, we encounter this loving God and we are saved from sin and we're giving a new life. Every day you're giving a new life. In most religions, human beings are reaching for God. Only in Christianity is God reaching out to us. This is the reason that a lot of theologians argue that when talking about God, you have to begin with Jesus, for in Christ we experience the true nature of God. But I believe the best argument for God's reality is through a personal experience that I mentioned earlier. You can throw philosophical darts back and forth, arguing about God's existence, if God is real or not, but it's only when you and I allow ourselves to experience God's love in Christ that we truly believe, and once we're believed, the Bible says that we will be changed. So if you're the same grumpy person that you were after your experience, I'm not sure you had an experience. That's between you and God. We may have intellectually believed that God is real. I mean, we've learned it all of our lives through Sunday school and missions training and all the things that we do as a church. And we believe intellectually that God is real. But it only makes a difference when we give him our hearts, when we really live for Christ. God spoke through the prophet Jeremiah when he said in Jeremiah 29:13, when you search for me, you will what? You will find me if you seek me with all of your heart. Isn't it interesting that it doesn't say if you search for me once a week, if you search for me occasionally, if you search for me with just a part of who I am. It doesn't say that. It says if you seek me with what? All of your heart, all of your heart, all of it. It's a story I read this week about a deep discussion in a Bible study class one day. The subject was being born again. And a national magazine had just done a story on this issue, and the class wanted to discuss it. So the teacher of the class that day was a prominent doctor in the community, and he said to the class, 5 years ago, I didn't believe in God. I hated the idea of God, and I hated the church. I was a man of reason, of science. I was way too smart for that kind of stuff. And I was living the life. I was making a lot of money as a big shot doctor. Then I came home late one night to an empty house. There was a note on the kitchen table for my wife and kids that read, "We don't know you anymore." He said, at that moment, I fell backwards into a 10,000 fathoms deep pit. For the first time in my life, the thing I wanted most, I could not have. And I fell back further and further and further. Then something reached down to pull me out. And something grabbed and pulled me up. And I got grabbed. I got pulled up. I got saved. I was born again. Then the doctor looked at the class and asked, "Does God exist?" "You bet he does, because he saved me." Do you really want to know if God is real? Then give God your heart. The only way to know for absolute 100% proof is that God is alive and real in your life and in your heart. And you express that love every day by what we do and the choices we make and how we share our love. Ask God to cleanse you of all of your sins and to put a new spirit within you. Once you've experienced God's love, the question's no longer going to be, "I wonder if God is real," but the question should be, "How did I exist without God in my life?" Have you ever been to a funeral home or a hospital or something, or talked to someone about someone who's ill? And I hear people say, "I just don't know how they make it without the church." There are so many lonely people out there that just don't understand that God's love comes through us. We become God with skin on. Not that we will ever be God, but that God uses us to reach out for him. God is real in my life. I hope that he's real in your life, and I hope that you can communicate that to other people. Whether you realize it or not, it is a question of our culture. Who is God to you?
He is.
He is.
He is.
He is a consuming fire.
He is light. He is big.
He is truth.
He is. He is.
He is infinite.
He's Jehovah. He's Alpha and Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's our eternal hope. He's our blessed hope.
He is creator. He is sustainer. He is infinite. He is present. He is here.
Él es mi vida.
He is grace.
He's my deliverer. He's my healer.
He's my redeemer, my sustainer in trouble, my life, my hope.
My hope.
He is the awesome God of the Bible.
He is my God. He is my Father.
He is Savior. He is my Savior.
He is my friend, the healer of all my wounds.
The healer of my wounds.
He's our bridge across the troubled waters. He's also a God that does what he promised he would do.
He is true, my all, the light that pierces the darkness, the rim on every cloud. He's in every sunrise because he's the creator of all things large and small.
Él es Dios.
He is grace. He is the forgiver of all my sins.
All my sins.
He gave me another chance.
He is love, and he loves me.
He is indescribable, unsearchable, and yet he knows me.
He's everything to me. He's God because he made himself God.
He is my God.
He's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
He was.
And he is.
And he always will be. He is unchanging.
He is the great I am. He is God. He is the Holy Spirit. He is Jesus. He is.
Who is he to you?
I want to challenge you to go a little bit later today and get on the social network and go to the Facebook page of our church. And I'm going to list that question, who is God to you? And I hope that you will take a moment and fill it out, who is God to you. It'd be cool to have a lot of different people express who God is to you. And so be looking for that sometime this afternoon, provided I'm still alive by then. If you haven't heard, I may have some tendencies of the flu. So that's why I came in late, and that's why I'm going to be leaving early. Please don't touch me. And leper, unclean, unclean. Okay, so just letting you know. And I pray that that God will continue to bless you. I want to pray for you. I think it's critically important that we make sure that we offer an invitation for people to come to know Jesus Christ personally. And let's do that today on this first Sunday of 2018. Pray with me. God, as we've studied different arguments, theological questions about God's reality, we know that God is real to us. And we all have a personal relationship with you. And I pray that for the person that doesn't, that they'll have faith today to do that, to make that next step in their lives. And help us as a church to cheer them on and to root for them. And we do that. I pray that they too will make a public profession of faith and that they will be baptized and become a part of the church as a whole. And by that, the local church here at First Baptist Church in Morganfield. Father, we love you and love what you're doing here. And we pray that you would give people just an extra sense of your blessings as we invite the Holy Spirit to come and to rest on us today. In Jesus' name, amen. As I prayed, if you've never received Jesus Christ in your heart, let's do that today. I can't imagine starting your life without God in your life, without Christ and the Holy Spirit, the three in one, as we sang about earlier today. And I pray that if you've never made that decision public, that you would do that today. That's always our hope. And maybe today you just need to recommit your faith in Christ, or you want to come and pray here. That's fine. We'll be sensitive to your needs as long as we need to be as a church. That's what we're here for. If this is a Sunday, you've decided that God is calling you to join this church, we would love to have you. This is when you would make that public decision, and let us encourage you in that. And whatever God does here from here on out is between you and the Lord. We just wanted to provide that opportunity. So stand with me, sing, pray, respond as God calls.
God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my guide. Hold me closely to his side. With love and strength for each new day, he will make a way. God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my guide. Hold me closely to his side. With love and strength for each new day, he will make a way.
had such a good time Thursday night at Doris's retirement celebration, and it's good to see her today. And I told you it wouldn't be too bad. I tried my best to embarrass her, but I don't think I did a good enough job. And but she is awesome, and I think we want to make sure that I wanted to do this several weeks ago, and there were we had a good crowd Thursday night. But Doris, come up here, and yeah, this will be fun. Doris, come up here. You're no longer my boss. You retired. On your way through, please stop by and congratulate Emily on her baptism. And please come by and just give Doris a hug and say thank you. I know a lot of people wanted to do that and couldn't come out Thursday night. So, yeah, please stay. Yeah. And people want to come and express their love to you and say thank you. And let's do that as a church for 23 years of great service. Yeah. She's going to stay right there. She's going to stay right there. You can be seated for another minute. I also wanted to say I saw Jeannie and Callie back there, and I wanted to tell you that we love you. And her mom passed over the last couple days, and service was yesterday in a beautiful church. And I know Steve came down and sang, and I hope I didn't infect anyone. I came down, and but you all have been in our thoughts and prayers. There are some other serious concerns going on within church families, some health needs, and so please pray for those as well. And when we can communicate, we will. When we don't, it means that we can't. And we honor people's, their personal deal. And so we want to make sure that we honor that as well. And Steve, you have anything you want to share? Bill, anything we need to share? Steve? All right, let's worship and praise God as we go to Bible study. We love you.
Savior.